Good morning, good afternoon, geometry class. Let's go over some of these questions. You do have a substitute today, so take out your packet. And I will be going over last night's practice assignment and also going over some of the questions on tonight's practice assignment. So very quickly, we'll be moving quick. So much material to cover. Get the packet out. We're starting on questions 4 and 5, and I believe that's on page 31 or 30. Oops, wrong page. Looks like we're starting on page 34. Page 34, question 4 and 5. Now, decide whether the congruence statement is true. Explain your reasoning. So I've highlighted side-side-side congruence postulate. That's the theorem that we've studied. And so let's see if I can use that theorem to prove that these two triangles are congruent. So segment GF is congruent to itself by the reflexive property. And let's make sure that the order is proper. FGH, F, G, and H. And this is GH and J, G, J, H, and G. So it appears to be correct. Proper order, so I would say yes. They are congruent by side, side, side postulate. Alrighty, next one. Triangle PQR is congruent to RST, so let's see what we have here. Let's look at our congruent markings. And it looks like we are congruent. Pay close attention here. So PQR, this is P, over to Q, over to R, and we have RTS, R, over to T, and over to S. Yep, it appears that the pattern is correct. And I think the most demanding component is this part here, that these two tick marks and these two tick marks make up the whole side, SR and PR. And so we do have a side-side-side relationship. Okay, now we're looking at the side-angle-side postulate. A slight glitch. We're on the wrong page. Let's get back to the right page. Here's the next question. Exercise 2, example 2. Prove triangles ABC is congruent to triangle DEF. This question will be done when we get back from vacation, but what you want to do is you want to prove that all of the corresponding sides are congruent by using the distance formula. And so I'll work this one out after we get back from Thanksgiving break. Next question. Decide whether the congruent statement is true. Explain your reasoning. And we've been talking about side, side, side. So, number 5, the answer is going to be yes. Side TR is congruent to itself by reflexive property. And so RST is congruent to RQT, triangle RQT. So the answer is yes by side, side, side posture. Triangle ABC, is that congruent to triangle DEF? Okay. ABC, is that congruent to DEF? And the answer is yes, by side, side, side congruence postulate. Moving on. Determine whether triangle ABC is congruent to triangle DEF. Explain your reasoning. Well, let's look at triangle A, B, and C. So I'm going to trace triangle A, B, and C. Starting at A, we'll call that 1. A, B, to C. Okay, is that congruent to triangle DEF? D over to E, this is also the first starting point, DE to F. Okay, are these triangles congruent? Well, we're looking for the side, side, side postulate, and here's my problem. There's no way I can prove that BC is congruent to EF. I don't know if these are good. As a matter of fact, I don't think they are. says this small piece here is 1, and this piece here is 2. So I don't think these are congruent. That last side can't prove that it's congruent. So I'm going to have to say no. It looks like there's no way to show that BC is congruent to EF. We just don't know that yet. Okay? Just don't know the total length. Okay, moving on. Complete the proof. We are given information. We've got to prove that those two triangles are congruent. Again, we're using side, side, side. So first step, we're given that A, segment AB is congruent to CD. So it looks like that's our given information. Right, so that's our reason. So let me write that over here in the corner. We're also given that BC is congruent to AD. It's also given. And always use your diagram and mark that information. And that's what's done here. See that? So we've got two tick marks. Total of two pairs of tick marks. I need a third pair of tick marks. So here it is. AC is congruent to AC, and that's the reflexive property. And so it's also the shared side property. And finally, we know the triangles are congruent since we have side, 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 three pairs of congruent corresponding sides. Side, side, side posture. Alrighty? We're moving quick. Got a heck of a lot to do, so let's keep moving. Okay, the next proof is, again, complete the proof. We've got our givens. Segment AB is congruent to segment CD. D is the midpoint of AC, segment AC. Prove that the triangles ABD and CBD are congruent. So, again, we start with our givens. AB is congruent, segment AB is congruent to segment CB. That's given. Again, the diagram has been marked. AB is congruent to CB. We're also given that D is the midpoint of AC, segment AC, and that's given. Now that's very important because a midpoint bisects a segment into two congruent parts, and that's what's going on here. You notice that AD is congruent to CD, and that's what's written here. And the reason why that's true is because that's the definition of a midpoint, right? So that's our reason. The definition of midpoint. So if they're congruent, let's add two tick marks, right? Continue with that. Now I just need another tick mark, and it looks like I found it. Segment BD is congruent to segment BD. That's the reflexive property. And there you are, guys. It's the first pair of congruent sides, second pair of congruent sides, and the third pair of congruent sides. That's your side, side, side. And I can mark it. Side, 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 right? And again, this is a reflexive property. So triangle ABD is congruent to triangle CBD, and that is by the side, side, side posture. Very nice. And remember the naming of the triangle, ABD. So I just want to make a point of that. So A was here. And notice A is the angle between the first tick mark and second tick mark. And so C better be the same. So there's C, the first tick mark and the second tick mark. See how they're corresponding angles? And B corresponds with B. Here it is. See that? Got the first and third from each triangle. Angle B is following that pattern there. And then angle D is here. And that's the second and third tick mark. Second and third tick mark. And so you have that guarantee that the angles are corresponding and congruent. And therefore, it's named properly. Ready? Okay, another proof. Okay, here we are. Now we're given just the reasons, but not the statements. So let's add the statement. So I'm going to change my color here to red. Now we're given that segment HI congruent to segment JK. So I'll write that down. Given, and it's also marked. HI, one tick mark. JK, one tick mark. So we have one pair of congruent sides. Again, I want to use the side-side-side congruence postulate. IJ, segment IJ is congruent to segment KH. So that's a given. Write that down. It's a given. Is it marked? Yep, two tick marks. I see it. Now, I'm put that third tick mark in. Here it is, guys. That's the JH, segment JH is congruent to segment HJ. That's the reflexive property of congruency. And so we know that the triangles are congruent. So, triangle. Now, here's how I'm going to name it. I'm going to name it as HIJ, first and second tick mark, the order I want to choose. It's congruent to triangle, first and second tick mark, JKH. Okay, and you can verify that that's the correct pattern. And my name, angle H corresponds with angle J. Right, angle I corresponds with K, and angle J corresponds to angle H. So far, so good. Like what I see. All right, we're moving on. Let's keep trucking. Okay, this is the side-side-side congruency pattern. And so just find all the values that make the triangles congruent. So you've got to have corresponding sides that are congruent. And so what I know is that this side here corresponds with this side there, and the lower side corresponds with the upper side. See that? And so since they correspond and the triangles are congruent, we also know that the shared side would be congruent. But it's just to solve for the values of x. So I'm going to do that. So let's match up our left and right sides. So that would be 2x plus 3, 7x minus 12. Alrighty, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to subtract 2x. The 2 moves at once. And then I'm going to also add 12. Okay, so that's gone. 15. Five x. It's gone. So divide by 5. The value of x is 3. And I don't like writing it this way per se. I prefer to write the variable first, then the value of the variable. And I like boxes instead of circles. So yeah, sounds good, right? Making progress. Great job. Keep it up. Stay sharp. Stay focused. Okay, we keep going. Okay, postulate 20. We're now talking about the side angle side postulate. This is different. Pattern is totally different. And so instead of going over 1 and 2 first, I think I'm going to jump ahead and work some other questions first and then come back to this. So let's see. Now that I think of it, the order should have changed and what I assigned. So I want to look at these questions first. And the page for these questions are on 40. So I'm looking at 40 first, and I think this will help us solve the other congruency patterns on the previous pages. So I didn't realize that, but there it is. This is a better way to start. So taking a good look at those questions, here's what they say. Use the diagram to name the included angle between the given pair of sides. So that's the idea behind the side angle side, is if I write side angle side, what is between the two S's? An angle. And that's called an included angle. And so, for instance, if I look at side GH, G and H is here, right? And then look at side HI, which is here. What angle is included or between these two sides? In other words, the sides that are highlighted, what angle do they create? That angle. The sides become the legs of the angle. See it? And that's your angle. So the name of that angle is, we call it angle H, if it's clear that that's the only angle I'm talking about. Or you can name it the traditional way, which would be angle GHI. See how I did that? GH to I, right? Or IH, G. H is the vertex, though, so it must be in the center. So let's try these a couple of times. Ready? Let's try to find the included angle, HI and IG. Okay? So HI and IG. There we go. The included angle is that angle there. And so we can name it. Now it's confusing because if I call it I, I'm not sure if I'm talking about the bottom angle or the top angle. So I've got to call it angle HIG. Okay? Continuing. Now we've got side IG and side HG. Okay, and what's the angle? The included angle is here. So the name of this angle would be IGH or HGI. Okay. All right. Continue with this. We have segment GI and segment IJ. And the angle is down here at the bottom. So that would be angle GIJ or JIE. Number five, J and G, and I and G. So, my angle is here. So the name of that would be hold on a second. Got a phone call. Let me answer this, and I'll be right back. Hey, apologies. That was my son. He's just got out of football practice. So he's telling me, hey, come pick me up. So he's walking over here to the classroom. And, yeah. So anyway, that's my story, and I'm sticking to it. So we've got that angle. Now, the next angle, the included angle, okay, we've got I, J, and G, J. There's my included angle, which is J. And so there's no confusion by just calling it J. Okay. So very nice, right? Makes perfect sense, I hope. So let's look at the other questions that I skipped. So I'm going to be bouncing backwards. I have to sneeze here, so I'm going to pause. Okay, so I'm back at this here. And going backwards, stepping back. And let's see, we stopped there. Now we're here. So now I want to talk about this side angle side. And it's directly related to what I just described, where you've got these sides and the angle is between the sides. It's called the included angle. Okay? And so that's this particular pattern here. It's called the side angle side pattern. And so decide whether there is enough information given to prove that the triangles are congruent using the side angle side congruence postulate. So let's check it out. Okay. So I think there is. Look. Very closely. Watch what I do here. This is my angle here. This is my triangle here. And I'm just highlighting the marked sides and angles. And notice that I didn't, when I did the markings here, the highlighting, I didn't travel in this direction. Watch, let me show you. I didn't do this. I didn't do that, did I? See, I want to traverse or travel along the sides of the triangle in the shortest, quickest possible way to ensure that I traverse or cross all the sides that have their markings and angles. So you always start at these tick marks or arc angle measures there. And what you do is you start at those marks, and then you travel across the triangle. Now, I don't want to start in the middle, because if I start in the middle, you notice that I go here, then I go here, then I got to go back. And you can't, you're not allowed to do that. You're not allowed to double up. So I start here and there, and I've covered all the arcs and tick marks. So that's the shortest possible way. Same thing here. See that? And the pattern there is your included angle. See them? And this is your side. This is your angle. Right? And this is your other side. And that's called the side angle side pattern. You have the same pattern on the other triangle. So that's the side angle side pattern. And that's enough to show that the triangles are congruent. So are they congruent? Oops. You'd say yes by the side angle side congruency postulate. We have the same scenario here. And the answer is yes. Now here's why. Again. My side, angle, and side. Side, angle, and side. But wait, Mr. Jacobs, I don't see an arc. Tells me that this angle is congruent. Well, sure you do. We know something about vertical angles. And vertical angles are created by intersecting segments or lines, and they create congruent angle measures. So these are vertical angles, and they're congruent. And so there's your pattern. Side, angle, side. Side, angle, side. This is the included angle between the two sides. Again, you could label it as S for side, angle, letter A, and S for side. We've got that same pattern over here. Side, angle, side. And so the answer is yes. By side, angle, side. Very nice. So let's pick up the pace here and look at the very next question. So what do you think? Are these two triangles congruent? What do you think? I don't know. So we have to be careful about this. We have to be very careful when we look at the markings here. Okay. All right, we're back. We're back live here. And so we're going to be very careful with this question. It can be rather confusing if you don't focus. So what I'm going to say here is that X, Y, is congruent to itself, x, y. So now watch how this occurs here. Now look at this triangle here, w, x, y, okay? Looking at this triangle. And I see the included angle. See it? So that would be my side, angle, side. Now you notice the angle is included or between the two sides, right? Right. That's an A, by the way. Now, let's look at the other triangle. circuit VXY. Now, looking at VXY, here's what I notice. Here is my side. Here's my other side. But notice that the included angle, side, and the angle's out here. So that's what we said we do not want to spell in that class. We don't want to spell ASS, no, or SSA. We prefer the SAS when the A is included or between the two sides. This is not the case. A is on the outside. It's supposed to be there, but it's not. So this is not the right congruency pattern. Therefore, they're not congruent triangles. All right. Whipping right through these questions. I hope they're making sense. Now we're going to jump into a proof. And we've attempted to introduce proofs. They're demanding. They're tough. So let's jump right into it. Let's start our two-column proof here. So you've got your statements and reasons. Here are my statements. Here are my reasons. Okay, let's work with my givens. I'm given that AB, segment AB, is congruent to segment DB. Okay, and that's given. Notice it's marked. AB is congruent to DB. We've got it marked. That's a side, so I'll put an S there. Number two. It's also called a leg, since this is the right triangle, by the way. We're looking at the hypotenuse leg theorem. It's a new theorem, okay? Now, so I'm gonna instead of putting S, I'm going to put L there for leg. Now, step two. We've got a perpendicular line. So we have segment BC, perpendicular segment. It's perpendicular to AB. Okay? And that's also given. Now we know that perpendicular segments form right angles, which are 90 degrees. Okay? And so we've got that information. So I'm going to write that down. I'm going to say that, angle ACB and angle DCB are right angles. And that's definition of perpendicular. Perpendicular segment. Okay? So I'll put a box there. Alrighty. Now what I have next is a right triangle now. So you notice I called this a leg? Shame on me, guys. That's an error. That's not a leg. This is a right triangle. And so, just trying to set you up here. So, the side opposite the 90-degree angle is not a leg. It's actually on a hypotenuse, which is the longest side of a triangle when it's a right triangle. So, that's H. This is a side H. This is a hypotenuse. And so, I've got an H here. I've got a right triangle. And so, now, I can say to myself that BC is congruent to itself, BC, which is the reflexive property. So I'll state that. That's the reflexive property. And so now I have a side, right? So that hypotenuse and a side. We don't call it the side. We call it a leg when it's a right triangle. So this is my leg. So I'll place an L here. And so now I have enough to say that these two triangles are, in fact, congruent by hypotenuse leg. It is the hypotenuse leg theorem. Okay, so triangle ABC is congruent to triangle DBC. So, it is not an easy theorem. Lots of steps here. It's the first time you've seen it, too, so should get easier with time. All right, guys, last theorem, last proof, and we'll call it a day. This is it. Okay, we're given some information. We're trying to prove that our segments are congruent. So we're going to have to do something called the corresponding parts of congruent triangles are congruent. We mentioned it a couple weeks ago. Now we're going to use it. So let's set up our two-column proof. Okay. These are our statements. These are our reasons. And here we are. So, I've got angle JKL is equal to the measure of angle MLK, and they're 90 degrees. So, they're marked. There they are. Good. We're given that segment JL is congruent to segment MK. I'm going to highlight those. Okay. And now, our job is to show that JK is congruent to segment ML. Let me repeat. That segment JK is congruent to segment ML. And so here's how I'm going to prove this. I'm going to separate these two diagrams since they're overlapping and that can make things rather confusing. So here's how I separate these two triangles. I'm going to trace them with my green marker. Okay. Close enough. And here's the other one. Okay. So, there's my first triangle. There's my second triangle. Okay? Make this a little more realistic. I'm going to stretch this out just a bit here. Okay, and widen it up just a bit. I think this makes it a little more realistic. Not quite wide enough yet. Okay, so the triangles are congruent now. So that would be this triangle there at the bottom, and this would be that triangle down at the top. So here's my point. I'm going to show that these triangles are congruent to show that these two sides are congruent. That's the goal. So I know this is the right angle, right? And the cool part is that if you look at the KL, that's this side here. And those are congruent to themselves. That would be the reflexive property. You see that? We also know that these are congruent, right? And our goal is to show that that these are congruent here, right? Let me just erase those. Well, how do you show that those segments are congruent? Well, by showing that these two triangles are congruent. I think I'm going to use the hypotenuse leg property, hypotenuse leg. And then show that since the triangles are congruent, so are their parts. So that's my strategy. So let's do that. So let's get rid of this stuff. Let's write it out. So I'm going to be moving quick. Bear with me. Okay, step one. It's given. Okay, step two. It's also given. Okay, step three. I'm going to say that K L is congruent to LK, and that's the reflexive property, okay? Segment KL that's the reflexive property. Alrighty. And so now I've got legs and the hypotenuse of these two triangles congruent to each other. So let me point that out. These would be the legs. This is the hypotenuse, right? But I've got to tell you that this is the right triangle, so I've got to state that. So number four. So triangle JKL and triangle MLK are right triangles. And since we have 90 degree angles there, it's the definition of right triangle. So now that I have right triangles, therefore I can say these two triangles are congruent. By hypotenuse, leg, congruency theorem. So if the triangles are congruent, so are their parts. And these three dots mean therefore. Therefore, segment JK is congruent to segment ML, and that is by the corresponding parts of congruent triangles are congruent. CP, CT, C. And we had mentioned that weeks ago. You may have forgotten it. But that's a wrap. So, good luck, guys. We are all done. Have a wonderful Thanksgiving. I'll see you next week. Have safe holidays and enjoy time with your friends, family, and those that you love. We'll see you soon. Bye-bye.